If you've ever looked at a flight tracker sometime around 10 or 11 p.m. Eastern, you might have noticed something. Perfect lines of planes stretching all the way to Europe. These are just some of the over 2,000 daily flights that cross the Northern Atlantic. With so many flights, there just has to be organization. This is the most direct route from New York to London. You may think it's this, a straight line, but that straight line isn't actually a straight line. This curved line is a straight line because, despite what some may think, the Earth is curved. From New York to London, the curve you see on a flat map isn't too extreme, but in the case of a longer flight, such as from New York to Bangkok, the most direct route is not this, but this, straight over the North Pole. It makes a lot more sense if you look at a North Pole-oriented map. If you draw the most direct route between Atlanta and London, you'll see that it passes over every major East Coast international airport. That means that planes from Atlanta to Europe travel on the exact same route as planes from Charlotte, Washington, Baltimore, Philadelphia, New York, and Boston. All these transatlantic planes typically leave between 6 and 8 p.m. Eastern to time their arrival for early morning in Europe. That means that there are potentially hundreds of planes all going the exact same route at the exact same time. The North Atlantic also has something known as the jet stream. These easterly winds average around 110 miles per hour, and if planes fly in them, they can cut hours off their travel time. However, the winds are only strongest in a line 3 miles high and 100 miles wide. That further concentrates the flights. On average, an eastbound transatlantic flight from New York to London takes about 6 hours and 15 minutes. Coming back against the jet stream, the same flight takes over 7 hours. Sometimes, the winds can be even more active, such as on January 8, 2015, when British Airways Flight 114 flew from New York to London in only 5 hours and 16 minutes, a new record for a commercial subsonic plane. On that day, the jet stream was blowing over 200 miles per hour, and the Boeing 777 reached a speed of 745 miles per hour, only 16 miles per hour below the sound barrier. So when winds can cut an hour off a flight, and a 777 burns 2,700 gallons of fuel per hour, and jet fuel costs $1.89 per gallon, that's a $5,103 difference between being in the right and the wrong winds. Hopefully you now see why this is important. So there are all these planes that are flying the exact same route, but usually that's no problem. The busiest route in North America, New York to Chicago, sees over 100 flights per day, leaving as frequently as every 5 minutes during the morning and evening rush. And these planes just fly the most efficient route. Before the flight, route planners file a plan with air traffic control, and during the flight, they're just directed by air traffic control in a way that keeps them 5 nautical miles from other planes. The difference between New York to Chicago and New York to London is that, over the North Atlantic, there is no radar. You see, radar only extends about 250 miles offshore. Transatlantic planes can be more than 1,000 miles from shore. That's why every morning, the route planners at Gander Air Traffic Control Center in Gander, Newfoundland, publish the day's North Atlantic tracks. The night before, every airline that will fly across the Atlantic the following day sends Gander a preferred route message, indicating what they think the best route will be. For the most part, Gander Center follows these requests and creates a set of 10 or so routes. These tracks attempt to get the most amount of planes on the most efficient route to Europe. The tracks are labeled, Zulu being the southernmost route, Yankee being the second southernmost, then X-ray, then Whiskey, and so on and so forth. Here's how a flight on the tracks works. And I'll warn you, this is when the video gets technical. Let's say we're going from New York to Paris. Around half an hour before scheduled departure, the captain talks to normal air traffic control to request clearance for the route up to around Newfoundland, Canada. In most cases, clearance is given, and soon after, we'll take off. About when the plane crosses the Gulf of St. Lawrence, the pilot will request the North Atlantic track that he or she desires. Here's today's message describing the day's routes over the Atlantic. After looking over this, the pilot decides to request track Whiskey. That means that, at least for now, we'll head towards the Raffin Waypoint, our oceanic entry point. Waypoints are fixed spots that are used for flight navigation. These are much easier for air traffic control to communicate to pilots than map coordinates when speaking over radio. Occasionally, you'll see some creatively named waypoints. Just north of Lebanon, New Hampshire, there's ham, burger, and fries. On approach to Kansas City Airport, there's spicy, barbecue, turkey, smoke, ribs. Boston has 2 waypoints in support of their sports teams, the Cubs and Bears. Some waypoint names are more somber. On the northern approach route to Washington Reagan National Airport, just miles away from where a plane hit the Pentagon on 9/11, the waypoints read, "We will never forget, September 11th. Since the North Atlantic tracks change every day, the modem just gives the entry and exit waypoints, and then coordinates for the route in between. Since the track coordinates are pre-programmed into the autopilot before takeoff, there's no reason to name them as waypoints, since they won't be given over radio. In the case of this flight, we're requesting track whiskey, and more than likely, Gander Control Center will give us permission. Although, sometimes they'll tell us to take a different track, usually because we're closer to another plane than the minimum separation distance. Since it's much more difficult to know where planes are over the North Atlantic, they're required to be 15 minutes separated, about 140 miles, rather than the normal 5 miles in areas with radar coverage. Assuming we're granted clearance, we'll head towards the RAFN waypoint and make sure that our satellite communication systems are working. Then we'll check to see if our high-frequency radio is working, a backup in case other communications go down. Minutes later, just after passing RAFN waypoint, the controller will say, "Radar services terminated. Have a good night." And we're on our own. All the North Atlantic tracks are preloaded onto autopilot, so there's really nothing to do except wait. When we hit 30 degrees west, we'll enter the Shanwick airspace approaching Western Europe. We switch our radios to Shanwick's frequency and fly a few more hours to our oceanic exit point, Gunzo Waypoint, meaning we've successfully traversed the Northern Atlantic. I hope you enjoyed this Wendover Productions video. Make sure to check out my last video on Guam here. Please also subscribe to this channel by clicking here. If you're already subscribed and not following me on Twitter, congratulations, you're in the 98.7%. But help me make that percentage smaller by going and following me on Twitter at WendoverPro. There's also a fan-moderated subreddit for this channel, which you can find at www.reddit.com/r/WendoverProductions. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you soon for another Wendover Productions video.